Mars is the watery planet. The sea, 70% of its surface. From our beginnings, we prospered off the sea. We fished it, traveled it, built our communities and lives around it. It was a gift, a bounty we would never be far from, for all our days. The sea is the perfect example of nature's generosity. It seems to be willing to feed us for free, forever. The sea can deceive and betray as well.
Take him on water, guys.
I got it.
Look out, you guys. We're going this way.
Put the water in, don't do that.
Put the water in, don't do that.
The seabed is littered with shipwrecks. Even the earliest mariners knew full well that this might be their ultimate destination.
Okay, there's the smoke flare.
I don't think he's...
Take it easy, guys. Okay. Take it easy. Let's not get
it. Please, we're rocking the boat. Please don't rock this.
Yeah, I can't hear you. Is there somebody that they're sending? Mayday! Mayday!
For thousands of years, fishermen have taken up this tough and uneven bargain. Even today, fishing is by far the deadliest profession in a great many countries. The Isle of Whithorn on the Irish Sea. Ringed by Ireland, Scotland, Wales, and England, and circling the Isle of Man, this sea is at the center of the ancient Celtic world.
The Isle of Commander, ruler of all things in sky and sea.
Here, on the coast of Scotland, a tiny fishing community is today mourning seven of its own.
Lord God Almighty, is that this act of worship would be for us all, and you beginning with you.
As in most traditional communities, fishermen work in families. Cousins, brothers, uncles start with an abiding trust that only deepens with time and water under the keel. When ships go down, families are lost with them.
We knew them all. This was what really devastated a community like this, when everybody's life really is interthreaded. But for all these young men to go in one go, and for three of them to go from one family, that just leaves one wee boy in that family.
The Irish Sea can be savage and unpredictable. It's comparatively shallow and confined by rocks, so wind and wave constantly reinforce and amplify each other.
So it's a hell of a place to record out. If you're caught out in bad weather, well, you have to try and get back home as soon as possible, because once it starts going bad, it really gets bad. Really nasty. Not a place to be caught out on.
Liverpool Coast Guard. Liverpool Coast Guard.
But people did get caught out. One night in January 2000.
Heading for Ramsey, Isle of Man.
The harbor of Douglas on the Isle of Man. A scallop boat called the Solway Harvester has suddenly and inexplicably vanished. In a blink, the
lifeboat volunteers are underway. The thin pinging of the Solway's emergency locator is all they have to go on. As if a heartbeat is all that remains of a friend.
This is a moment now. Dover's
lifeboat, this is Dover's boat. Let's go ahead, over.
Yeah, what's the next message? You're saying you've got something spotted, woman. Life raft.
But on this night, the rescuers are defeated. Two life raft cases, unopened, remain to tell the tale of the soul.
West, over.
By dawn, all hope is gone. It's all so familiar, as if it's a recurring nightmare. Even so, everyone has a theory about its cause.
The sea was terrible that day, wasn't it? Yeah. Force 9. She's built to be able to take that type of sea, so it's not really the sea's fault. It's the problems within the boat itself.
Even after the Solway is salvaged from a depth of 130 feet, there are no easy answers. People want to know why. Next time, it could be them. The captain of one of the Solway's sister ships is troubled.
But it's just a matter of going measure 16 place, or grabbing the one in 16, picking up, pressing your hand, mayday, mayday, mayday. It's instantaneous. You know, within 2 seconds, within a second, you could have done that.
Somehow, that call was never made. A boat upside down. The crew in their bunks. A sudden darkness and numbing cold. Thrashing about to find a way, any way, out as the ship plummets. When a ship is lost at sea, it's usually gone forever. The recovery of the Solway Harvester is a break with tradition. It holds the promise of learning how a modern ship could sink without so much as a mayday. But until the investigation is finished, the people of the Isle of Whithorn can only wonder.
The sea is the lesson.
You can't play with it.
You can't play with it.
You must respect it.
And while it gives a living, at the end of the day, it take as well as give.
Every sea takes, but some more than others. The North Atlantic, off the northeast coast of the United States. This place makes the Irish Sea look like a wading pool. Out here, you can go hundreds of miles without seeing land. It's so vast, the wind knows no bounds. Over the open ocean, sustained gales can build monstrous seas. It's a temperamental place where ships and lives are repeatedly lost. Close to 100 people died in 2000 alone.
Okay, target in sight at 2 o'clock. You're coming in, noise.
Roger, target.
In these waters, the Coast Guard saves 500 people a year.
By sheer luck, by the grace of God, I got into this job. Luckily, I get to go out and save people. And that's what the epitome of any Coastie is. Anybody in the Coast Guard is to go out and save somebody that's in trouble.
Boarding on 10. I will pick up signal.
Back up on the left.
It's about the closest you're going to get to feeling like a superhero. So it's not you just kind of show up, do it, and go home. It really does define like how you feel, how you carry yourself, and the confidence that you have as a person.
One of them could not swim, and you've heard of the expression, get the shirt off your back. I gave him my life vest off my back.
Put the 60 on the line. Put the ready 60 on the line.
The clock starts as soon as the call comes in. Either you get there fast or there may be no one to rescue.
POV now. Put the ready 60 on the line. I think three of them are survival suits and have already entered the water. I don't know the status of the other two.
Okay.
You don't calculate the odds. You just go.
The worst thing that I hate to hear when the SAR alarm goes off is people in the water. Especially when nobody really knows exactly where they are. A person fell off the boat 3 hours ago. Well, what kind of search pattern is that? You're basically looking for somebody's head. You're not going to see their body. You're just going to see their head float in the water. And it's more not so much the needle in the haystack, it's the head of a needle in a haystack is what you're looking for.
For centuries, when lives were lost out here, it often happened on the great mid-ocean shallows known as the George's Bank and the Grand Banks. For over 400 years, fishermen have gone at the masses of congregating fish here. The great submerged land masses cause the deep undersea currents to rise to the surface, laden with nutrients. Shallow waters that made the fishing easy can be whipped to a frenzy when the rough weather blows in. Over these banks and well beyond them, the mighty Atlantic swells and roars.
It's definitely brutal. Some days you get your windows where it's nice, but on a general rule of thumb, it's horrifying to miserable.
At its worst, I mean, this is the area where the perfect storm developed. They always hear about nor'easters, you know, when the wind comes out of the northeast here to New England. So it can be very treacherous. And they will call us on the radio and say, hey guys, the weather's rolling in. And that's what they say, because it doesn't look like it's rolling. It's like a giant white steamroller that's coming your way.
It's not just the weather. December 1996. The skipper of the Panther hears a sound that every fisherman dreads, an alarm from the pilot house.
It was getting dangerous. We were losing this boat. We were definitely losing this boat. This boat was going down. So we immediately went into the drill. I called the Coast Guard, and the first thing they sent out was the jet. And that was like looking at God, because knowing that you were going to go into the water, you knew that that guy could see where you were going into the water. And that was a wonderful feeling, having that Coast Guard jet circle you.
When we got on scene, it looked like a boat that was about to sink. That's what it looked like. The whole stern of the boat was submerged, and you couldn't even read the word Panther on the back. It looked like a lost cause to me.
As the ship foundered, three of the Panther's crewmen were airlifted off, but the captain had something else in mind.
And they asked me to evacuate also, and I told them that, you know, I have everything I own into this boat, and I was going to stay with it and try to save it.
It was a cruel choice, his boat or his life. But in fact, the Panther was his life. And like so many fishing captains, he just couldn't let her go.
The captain of his boat, I look at him as the president of his own nation. He has his people, he has his island, and he has what his little boat stands for. He doesn't want to see his island fail. He doesn't want to see it sink in the ocean. And he doesn't want anybody on board his boat get hurt.
Operating on pure instinct, the skipper went below decks and diverted water from the overloaded stern.
It's a scary place to be, is in the engine room. When you know something like that just happened, if the boat goes down, you're not coming out. There's no way you'll get out of that engine room through water into a survival suit in time. It'll never happen.
Just in time, a ship owned by an old friend arrived to escort the Panther home. The ship and her skipper were saved, but only just.
You don't want to see anybody lost. You don't want to see any of the boats lost in town or in any town. It affects you greatly whenever a boat goes down along the East Coast, especially in Maine, as many boats as we lost the last 2 years here. It's a tragedy.
It's a tragedy caused by more than just bad luck. All up and down the New England coast, there are fishing boats in disrepair.
Well, this boat you're standing on here is 23 years old, and we just went through a major refit. There's a lot of boats older. There's not been a new boat here for some number of years. There's been one or two, but those are the exceptions. They aren't the rule.
So have you had any problems in the past with leaks down in here?
Coast Guard inspectors are finding too many safety problems, and they're worried.
Minor, but we did when this bullet come out.
They can suggest fixes, but some boat owners ignore their advice, either because of money or a stubborn resistance to outside interference.
What are your plans for maintenance back in here? It looks pretty bad.
Yeah, I have serious concerns about the condition of this boat. I believe that it's at a risk for a sinking accident. It's got a lot of material condition problems, watertight integrity problems. It's at a much higher risk of that type of a flooding and sinking accident.
The fishermen are in a bind. Because of overfishing in the past, there are only a limited number of fishing days each season. It's hard for people to make a living, much less fix their boats.
Since the fish are starting to become more and more depleted, that means fishermen have to stay out longer and longer to find the fish. It takes longer to catch them, and the whole time you're continuing to expose yourself to these dangers.
All it takes is one little thing to go wrong, one bolt to pop, one bad fitting to blow, one bad section of hull to go, and you're done for, basically.
But who has such dark thoughts at the start of a fishing trip? January 2000, Portland, Maine.
The day we headed out was a beautiful day. It was a Sunday, and it was sunny, and it was flat, calm. Beautiful, and it was one of the, it's how you like to start a trip, you know?
Sean Rich had been out many times before. He was one of six brothers in a veteran fishing family. On this day, he was with two of the best fishermen he knew, his father and his cousin Harry, men who knew everything there was to know about the sea. Before the trip was over, Sean's world would utterly change. As they start their return to port, the sea begins to boil. They're suddenly trying to outrace a nor'easter.
The storm started to intensify. It took a couple of good seas right over the stern. When that sea came up and washed into the engine room, we knew we was in trouble. My father and I went into the galley, put on our survival suits.
This ship will not be saved. There's only time for a desperate call.
7022, 4309, we need help.
Miles to the south on Cape Cod, a Coast Guard helicopter begins its response.
Roger, sir. Land evacuation on the way.
With 40 knot headwinds, they're at least an hour away. By the time they reach them, the crew may be lost.
I climbed up onto the wheelhouse roof. When I looked back and my father was having trouble climbing up, they said, "Dad, give me a hand." At that point, I see him just look up at the sky because the boat began to roll. The boat's upside down, he's under it. I knew he was trapped, he was gone.
In taking time for the Mayday, Sean's cousin has not been able to pull his survival suit fully on. They're in trouble.
The shock, my temperature dropping very quickly. The waves would crash on us. I said, "Sean, I don't think we're gonna make it." At that point, I said to myself, "I'm gonna make it. There's no way I'm gonna die out in the middle of this ocean."
Meantime, their emergency locator drifts away as Sean struggles to keep his cousin's head afloat. The beacon is their only chance. Sean has a choice: stay with his cousin or swim for the locator. Without it, they'll both die.
I swam right to it, and I grabbed it. I turned and I saw Harry, and I swam back to him, and I made it back to Harry.
By the time Sean makes it back, only a lifeless body remains. For the next 2 hours, Sean tries to hold on.
When he drifted away and we drifted apart, it was a very lonely, scary feeling, alone in this ocean at nighttime, in this storm, wondering if even anybody was going to attempt to come find us because it was pretty nasty. So I hung on and I prayed. I prayed constantly. I just asked God to send somebody to find me.
What Sean needs is a miracle. That's the way it is with night rescues. They're always a close call.
It's so hard to see. The sky is black and the sea is black, so there's no horizon. If it's dark, it's pretty scary.
Looks like one guy.
So higher in. Gotta get out of the basket.
Sean's body temperature is dangerously low. Much longer, and he would have been gone.
One of the things that troubles me the most, and that has kept me awake many nights, is dealing with the fact that I watched my father die right in front of my eyes and couldn't really do anything about it.
For Sean and for all fishermen, it's not the sea's fault. It's just the way things are. They know their boats are fragile, and that even the best of fishermen can be lost. But for many, this is the way of life they know. It's where they come from. It's where they belong. No one belongs here. This is the North Pacific, off the coast of Alaska. And beyond the Aleutian Islands, the Bering Sea. It's the last place on Earth. In winter, hurricane-force winds throw steep and punishing seas at you. The sort of waves that can punch out wheelhouse windows. Still, this is where the money is. The Bering Sea harbors a motherload of crabs. And so the industry thrives through short and furious seasons.
It takes Olympic strength to be able to do that. Those guys don't work 8 hours. They don't start at 8 and then stop at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. They go out there, and the idea is the longer you're out there, the more fuel you're burning, and the fish are getting older in your holds, and there's more fish to be caught. So it's an Olympic-type athletic strength that you're going to have to stay up for 19, 20, 21 hours sometimes, maybe 24 hours.
They cope with some of the worst weather on the planet. It makes navigation tough and rescue even tougher.
Wave action and being that close to shore even makes the waves start to break and makes the waves bigger as it goes on the shore. Now I'm sure those chunks, there must have been chunks of ice that weighed 400 and 500 pounds. You would never lower your rescue swimmer into that situation because now you have another person. So it's a situation of so close yet so far away. They lower the basket. Now that person has to swim to the basket. And there's nobody to help him do that. And he's going to have to do it in his own power. And it's hard to be in ice in the Bering Sea and have to swim to the basket.
And the engineer had both gone overboard. The Coast Guard snatched them from the ice field, narrowly averting another dark statistic. Dutch Harbor, Alaska. The fitting out capital for the crabbing industry. This place is so remote, and this job so otherworldly, that Dutch Harbor has a look of desolation about it. It's like some jumping-off base for deep space on some forlorn moon. A last-ditch glimpse of normalcy before the unpredictability sets in.
Attention all mariners, this is the National Weather Service with marine forecast. The outlook calls for southeast winds 30 to 40 knots, seas 15 to 20 feet. Winds will be gale force Saturday, Sunday, and Monday morning. For the Bering Sea offshore.
As they fiddle with their crab pots one last time, the fishermen all know what they're headed for. Will their luck hold out? Can they withstand one more roll of the dice? Though Dutch Harbor has seen a thousand tragedies, one stands out. It's a story almost 20 years old. But one that every fisherman remembers. What went wrong has never quite been sorted out. And as everyone knows, unresolved tales are by far the most haunting. The Bering Sea has always been trouble. But there was a time and place where people felt they could defy it. This tale begins 2,000 miles to the south, in the town of Anacortes, Washington. For years, the people of Anacortes fished the gentle waters of the Puget Sound for salmon. Fathers passed on their trade to their sons. Nobody got rich, but it was a living. Things changed in the 70s when the crab boom hit the Bering Sea. Overnight, Crab became a multi-million dollar catch. Crew members came home with $50,000 for a few months' work. Skippers averaged three times as much. Crab fever hit Anacortes hard. Young fishermen jumped at the opportunity. After two good seasons, Jeff Hendricks had a new appreciation for the riches of the Bering Sea. He built a new crab fleet for Anacortes, the A-boats, the Alyeska, Antares, Americus, and Altair. Like little Titanics, they were designed to be unsinkable. Built in the local shipyard and crewed by local boys, they were the pride of Anacortes. The ships were so well fitted out that surely nothing could go wrong. At least that's how it struck Rick Harvey.
I can remember walking into the galley on one of these A-boats when they're really decking the galleys out and stuff and thinking, you know, these are nicer than most people's kitchens.
It was the ultimate boys' adventure and they were getting paid for it. Most of them were making more in a few months than their parents did in a year. Brian Melvin was only 25, but already he was skipper of an A-boat.
Basically, with those boats, you go out and work them 24 hours a day, and if you kept working hard, you were going to have a successful season.
1983. The boys are due to leave Anacortes for the long voyage north and the start of the crab season. At the last minute, Rick Harvey decides not to go.
My brother wasn't doing anything at the time, and he had been salmon and herring fishing, so he actually slipped in the spot where I left. So that's how my brother Randy actually ended up on the boat, and to this day I can picture all those guys standing up in the wheelhouse.
Reach Dutch Harbor, where they begin loading crab pots. Each pot weighs about 700 pounds. Each boat will pile on about 220 pots. Each captain must make sure his boat is stable under all that weight. On the morning of St. Valentine's Day, A-boat skipper Brian Melvin overhears something disturbing on the ship to shore.
I had the radio down, but I heard it and I turned it up because I didn't know what was going on. And I heard him ask which one of the A-boats were out at sea. So it could be one of the A-boats upside down out of Dutch Harbor.
No way an A-boat could be upside down. Brian turns the Alyeska around and steams toward the position of the overturned hull. As if on cue, the sea kicks up. There's no mistaking the overturned hull of the Americus. Held up by trapped air, the boat could plummet at any moment, her crew trapped inside.
I had a couple guys that probably would have went over the side and swam over that boat and, pounding the hull or whatever. But the sea conditions were, way too bad to allow somebody to do that. But it was a pretty helpless feeling.
As Brian watches the Americus disappear, he thinks of his brother, a crewman on the Altair. He tries to raise him on the radio, but the altar is silent.
It was almost unfathomable to think that, you know, something could happen to those guys. You know, things were bad enough already without even thinking about that.
Why doesn't the Altair respond? Brian is forced to think the unthinkable. The Altair might also be in trouble. He begins a desperate search for his brother. A week goes by, and with it, all hope. Like the Americas, the Altair is lost.
It was tough coming home. I think I knew that when I told my mom and dad I was coming home, that there was probably no hope for my brother, you know, and
two boats, 14 crew members, gone. It was the single worst disaster in modern American commercial fishing. John's grief was only deepened by the baffling mystery.
That's your daddy's first captain. Yeah. That's your daddy's best friend.
Why did it happen? How could two boats be lost in calm seas so close to Dutch Harbor? Captain John de Carteret of the Coast Guard was assigned to the case. It would consume him for more than a year.
The thing was that we knew from the films that were taken, the vessel floating upside down, that there was no damage apparent on the hull. And neither vessel was even heard to put out a distress signal or anything. So these vessels just disappeared overnight.
It's no surprise when old and unmaintained ships go down. But the Bering Sea had swallowed two perfectly new ships. Why? Was there a hidden flaw? Every fishing community has a font of collective wisdom it turns to in times like this. Old men know the sea.
Well, the way I had it, they loaded these pots on. They were 800 pounds apiece. And they loaded them right even with the top of the house.
That boat right there is a picture of it. We saw it roll over in just a
second.
Not a big sea either.
I just thought that boat was way too heavy, you know, on top.
I knew 29.
The Carteret suspects they're right, but he has no proof.
There you go.
He calls in Bruce Ady, a stability expert at the University of Washington.
As you can see, we have a lead block here that we can move up or down, and with that we can control the center of gravity of the vessel and hence its stability.
One way or the other, it's going to...
When a boat capsizes,
go over, right?
Happens so quickly the crew has no time to call for help.
We need to go get it. That sort of goes...
Could this be why the missing A-boats didn't send a mayday? Hundreds of sophisticated tests and calculations later, Ady has no better luck than de Carteret.
We were feeling that frustration was really taking over, so we decided we would go back to the shipyard and start all over again. And one of the assistant investigators was over talking to one of the painters. And the painter said, well, I don't know if this means anything, but he said the last time the vessels were in here, we painted the boot striping up a foot higher than it was on the picture of the vessel. And then, bingo, a light went on.
Circling the hull, the boot line could show how low a boat is riding in the water, an indication of whether or not it was overloaded. But on a fishing vessel, there were no guidelines for where it should be painted.
So right away, this meant that the vessel was a foot deeper in the water than we had calculated. We were calculating on the boot striping the way it was put on the design plans of the vessel.
The decks of the Americus and the Altair would have been precariously close to the sea. Water may have swamped them with every pitch and roll.
I think they left Dutch Harbor. They probably all, except one person, went to sleep. And we're traveling along and maybe got into a confused sea or following sea, and they just rolled over. Almost within a few seconds, just disappeared.
The A-boats were magnificent, vastly more than fishing boats. They were sophisticated machines. But to sail them, you needed a deep understanding of stability and wind and wave and ice. In the quest for profit, few captains took the time for training in those days. In the A-boats, technology had come too far, too fast, beyond the ability of man to stay apace. But even after the A-boats went down, people continued to go north for crab.
Bering Sea, of course, is a place that is desolate, lonely, and very, very unpredictable. Storms can arise up there in a matter of hours. And the men that go up there to fish are a breed unto themselves.
It really does define who they are as a person. We are lobstermen, and we are sword fishermen, and we go fishing for halibut in Alaska. And they probably can't envision themselves doing something else. And if they're going to die or they're going to be hurt, they might as well be doing it fishing.
Safety regulations were beefed up in the wake of the A-boat disaster. The Coast Guard now works more closely with fishermen, and deaths have decreased. There are also new regulations to protect the crabs from overfishing. For the fishermen, it means trying to catch a season's worth of crab in less time and still get home alive. For all the changes, commercial fishing is still remarkably dangerous off Alaska. In 1999 alone, 29 fishing boats were lost and 17 people drowned. And still, they go. Portland, Maine, 2000 was a bad year. Three boats and five fishermen were lost. The worst toll in memory. Why do they do it?
I think it's just in our blood to do it. I mean, we just wouldn't be complete without being on the water, whether it's inshore lobstering or offshore fishing. It's just, we couldn't be happy behind a desk or in the city or, you know, whatever. It's just who we are.
Soon after his ordeal, Sean Rich was again out doing the job he loves. Lobstering is a family tradition in Maine. Calm and prosperous, it's as much a pastime as a job. These are the best of times. But every day like this will have to be earned by wintry days on the open ocean. Sean knows it was his survival suit that saved his life. He wants to make sure his brothers have the same chance.
It's good to know that we all really love each other, and we just grow and we get stronger. We get stronger and closer as brothers, and it's It's nice. It's nice having a big, strong family.
I can't stand up!
Put on your back now.
In Scotland, a year after the sinking of the Solway, the investigation dragged on. Tantalizing clues pointed to technical problems, like a missing hatch cover. But there were no final answers, and no one to blame.
It's always important in a fishing disaster to find out, if you can, what has happened. It's a risky enough game, fishing. Probably one of the most dangerous games in the world. And you want to try and reduce the odds, if you can.
No one has forgotten the loss of the Solway Harvester. But today, a new generation is learning to cope with the winds and the waves.
Pencil it in again. Keep looking in front of you.
At the local sailing school, they're putting the tragedy behind them.
Just shortly after that accident, I wondered whether it was right that I should continue teaching people to go to sea. But when I see the pleasure these young kids get and how much fun they have, then, I keep going.
Less than a month after the loss of the Solway, another ship was in trouble off the coast of Scotland. The Be Ready was on fire, and her crew had to scramble to safety. Why do they do it? For the money, yes. But also for the freedom, the adventure, and their common bond with the past.
I like coming and going as I please. I enjoy nature. It's a way of life. It makes me happy when we leave, and it's a thrill coming back to the dock when you have the fish hole full. You've accomplished what you set out to do. I love it.
All they ask in return is a chance to survive. As the sailor's hymn has it, O sacred spirit, who didst brood upon the chaos dark and rude, oh, hear us when we cry to thee for those in peril on the sea. Is the watery planet. The sea, 70% of its surface. From our beginnings, we prospered off the sea. We fished it, traveled it, built our communities and lives around it. It was a gift, a bounty we would never be far from, for all our days. The sea is the perfect example of nature's generosity. It seems to be willing to feed us for free, forever. The sea can deceive and betray as well.
Take them on water, guys.
I got it.
Look out, you guys. We're coming this way.
Put the water in, don't do that.
Put the water in, don't do that.
The seabed is littered with shipwrecks. Even the earliest mariners knew full well that this might be their ultimate destination.
Okay, there's the smoke flare.
I don't think...
Take it easy, guys. Okay. Take it easy. Let's not get
it. Please, we're rocking the boat. Please don't rock this.
Yeah, I can't hear you. Is there somebody that they're sending? Mayday! Mayday!
thousands of years, fishermen have taken up this tough and uneven bargain. Even today, fishing is by far the deadliest profession in a great many countries. The Isle of Whithorn on the Irish Sea. Ringed by Ireland, Scotland, Wales, and England, encircling the Isle of Man, this... The Irish Sea can be savage and unpredictable. It's comparatively shallow and confined by rocks, so wind and wave constantly reinforce and amplify each other.
It's a hell of a place to be caught out. If you're caught out in bad weather, well, you have to try and get back home as soon as possible, because once it starts going bad, it really gets bad. Really nasty. Not a place to be caught out on.
Liverpool Coast Guard, Liverpool Coast Guard.
But people did get caught out. One night in January 2000.
Heading for Ramsey, Isle of Man.
The harbor of Douglas on the Isle of Man. A scallop boat called the Solway Harvester has suddenly and inexplicably vanished. The sea is at the center of the ancient Celtic world.
Ruler of all things in sky and sea.
Here, on the coast of Scotland, a tiny fishing community is today mourning seven of its own.
Lord God Almighty, is that this act of worship would be for us all, and you beginning with you.
As in most traditional communities, fishermen work in families. Cousins, brothers, uncles start with an abiding trust that only deepens with time and water under the keel. When ships go down, families are lost with them.
We knew them all. This was what really devastated a community like this, when everybody's life really is interthreaded. But for all these young men to go in one go, and for three of them to go from one family, that just leaves one wee boy in that family.
In a blink, the Royal National Lifeboat volunteers are underway. The thin pinging of the Solway's emergency locator is all they have to go on. As if a heartbeat is all that remains of a friend.
Yeah, what's the next message? You're saying you've got something spotted? Open. Life raft.
But on this night, the rescuers are defeated. Two life raft cases, unopened, remain to tell the tale of the Solway.
West, over.
By dawn, all hope is gone. It's all so familiar, as if it's a recurring nightmare. Even so, everyone has...